Welcome everybody, and tonight we're going to cover a lot of information on, of course, a sensitive topic that, unfortunately we still live in a situation where we're only allotted certain options in terms of cancer. And so we don't really think outside the box because we're not told that there is an outside of the box. You know, it's basically chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, those are the options. And anything that steps outside of those frames, you know, we're told that it's not proven, it's not FDA approved, which is true. It's not FDA approved in a lot of these cases. But, you know, it's not scientific, et cetera, et cetera. We get told all these things. And, you know, so tonight I want to cover some of the, and just some of the issues and options that are out there that are currently available, but may just not be available to us. Okay, so we can really start to get a better framework of this and how it all gets put together. So we're going to be covering a lot of detail at the end of it. I'm actually going to have my sister. If you guys don't know, she is she's a pharmacist, ex-pharmacist, and she was diagnosed with cancer, thyroid cancer, about 6 years ago. And she has gone through quite a journey with all of it, but is doing fantastic and has completely changed her lifestyle. Completely changed everything. So she's going to be coming on. We'll be Skyping her in at the end of it. That'll be the last thing to finish it all up. So everybody say hello to the Facebook crowd. We've got some, we are live on Facebook, so keep your questions clean. We are also, of course, recording this for YouTube to put on our ledger there. And so anybody can go back and watch that later. And that brings us to the first question, the first slide, if you will. What is the difference between a doctor and a scientist? And the reason why I cover this is because inevitably we get, you know, I get comments on YouTube, I get comments, you know, like, what does a chiropractor have to do with cancer? You know, what authority does a chiropractor have to do with cancer, right? Seems like a good question, a logical question, especially if you don't like chiropractors. But think about the purpose in this question. If you look at the difference between a doctor and a scientist, what is the difference? What is the main difference? Because there is a very big difference between the two. See, a scientist, what is their job?
Research,
to figure out what's going on, to figure out the answers, okay? What is the job of a doctor?
To apply.
To take the stuff that the researchers, the scientists, come up with, and then bring that to a level of application to the patient. Okay? So in terms of cancer, the very question, what does a chiropractor have to do with cancer, and what makes you an authority? The answer is obvious. We're not authorities on it. We don't claim to be authorities on it. All we do is take our information, our education, which is a lot of it. You know, we have the same education standards as any other doctorate program. We take that education and then we distill the information that's out there. Because, see, at this point in time, There's a far left and there's a far right. I mean, there's on the far end this way, you've got doctors who prescribe drugs without question. You know, they don't think about it. They don't process it. If your number is here, you get this drug. If your number is here, you get this drug. It's completely indiscriminate. There's not a lot of thought process. It's just writing scripts all day. Okay? So my question would be, well, what makes them an authority? We know it's the white coat, right? It's the degree. That's what makes them the authority. On the other end, you've got, you know, people that what I call Facebook physicians, you know, who when you post a question on Facebook about something, they have the answer to all of it because they read all kinds of articles on the internet, right? They've got apparently so much time to research, you know, that they know more than doctors who have the education to distill the information that they're reading about. You know, so you've got these far ends in between, and the unique position of a chiropractor is simply that because we don't have the built-in credibility of the white coat, we didn't buy our credibility. In fact, we have to earn our credibility like nobody else because we're not automatically believed, right? So we have to take that education and we have to bridge those gaps and figure out what is right, what is not right, and to help you guys wade through the waters. So that is the difference between a doctor and a scientist. So if I'm asked what gives me the authority to talk about it, I don't need authority. I'm not looking for authority to talk about it. What gives me authority to talk about it is that I spend sometimes 12 to 24 hours of research outside of all the other stuff that I have to do during the day to put together a 1-hour workshop so that you guys don't have to, right? And so that the people on YouTube don't have to, that choose to watch. But they have to choose to watch. They have to choose to learn, right? Okay, next question. What is the difference between an allopath and a vitalist? Okay, those are big words too, right? An allopath is a medical doctor. Okay, they believe that basically the body is a mechanical system that breaks down and ages over time like a car or a refrigerator, right? And so when it breaks down, it's the job of the doctor to take those parts and try to fix them and put them back together. And so the job of a doctor is keep replacing and fixing parts as long as you can to extend life and, you know, hopefully get some quality out of it. A vitalist believes completely different. He believes that the body is made the way that it's made. It's not a refrigerator. Okay, you can't take out parts and expect things to work. You can't just interchange things. If you take out your tonsils, what replaces it? If you take out your appendix, what replaces it? Your gallbladder. On and on and on. So we look at the body as a self-developing, self-healing, self-organizing being that our job as doctors is to support the integrity of that system so that it continues to heal and operate as opposed to just breaking down and then replacing the parts once they go bad, right? So there's a mountain of difference between the two. Now, again, each person has their individual right to choose which path they want to take. You know, you don't have to be a doctor to choose if you're an allopath or a vitalist. It's a personal opinion, like a conservative and a liberal, you know? And honestly, if somebody chooses to go allopathic, it's not my place to tell them that they're wrong. It's my place to educate, and then from there, they can decide if they want to believe or not. Either way, it's fine. I'm fine, you're fine, we're all fine, right? To each his own. All right, so you try to stick your needles in my kids, right? Okay, so PNC 27, getting into the information. PNC 27, publications date back to 2001 on this substance. PNC 27 specifically was first discovered in 2006. So they started looking at these molecules as far back as 2001 in their application to cancer treatments. Okay, but 2006 is when they actually licensed the first one. They first started talking about this. These are the research articles that are on the PNC website. Dr. Ehsan Sarafraziadze has a video, Targeted Cancer Therapy, available from TEDx Connecticut College from 2012. All of these slides, they will be on. You can go back and watch the Facebook video. You can go back and watch the YouTube video later, and you can review through all this information. When we put these on YouTube, they always are full screen. You can pause it on that page and copy down anything that you want to. So go back and watch that video because this is an American doctor that works in an American university that understands and educates on this stuff and is pushing to get it approved in the United States. And he was speaking in America at Connecticut College on this topic in 2012. Okay, what year is it? 2016, still not approved. Okay, it's still not there. Okay, it has been studied on 39 different cancer lines completely eliminating the cancer population of 1 million cells in culture in 72 hours or less. 72 hours or less, every cell on the plate is dead. Okay? Has been studied on monkeys with no effect on the hematopoietic system, the bone marrow. So it has no effect on the bone marrow. It does not harm it in any way, shape, or form. Okay? Next one. Okay, PNC27 is a peptide designed by a supercomputer and derived from the proteins of a moth and a fruit fly. This is not junk science. Okay, this is not something that, you know, some homeopath in the middle of Nevada put together in his back kitchen, right? They use a supercomputer to design this molecule, and then they used existing fragments to put it together and make a usable product. And they actually went through multiple different peptide forms before they came to the most effective one, which was PNC27 specific. Okay, what it does, it mimics the P53 protein, which functions as a tumor suppressor in healthy people. With cancer, this gene is mutated and the cell continues to divide unregulated. That's what's harmful about cancer, right? Is it continues to divide unregulated outside of the boundaries of what the nervous system typically allows, until it consumes so much of the energy of the body that it doesn't leave anything left for the normal healthy tissue, and you begin to lose weight, drop energy until organs fail and shut down, right? Essentially killing the being as a whole, including itself. So once again, being that I'm not the scientist, right? I put all this on here, so if you really want to know what P53 exactly is, and what all these, you know, the HDM2 receptor sites, all this stuff is, you know, all this stuff is information that is available. The whole purpose in all this is to make sure that everybody knows what to look for and where to look, because you're not going to see it here. You're not going to go to your oncologist here and have them talk to you about this. It's not going to be an option, okay? It targets a protein on cancer cell membranes only. So only the cancer cells have this particular site, HDM2, which when it connects to them, it rapidly forms pores in the cell membrane. Okay, so think about it. If you've got a balloon and you take a pin and you pop a hole in it, what happens? It blows up, okay? So you have, if you take a, you know, let's make a little bit more logical or direct comparison. Take a water balloon and put a water balloon down into a bucket of water, okay? So you've got water inside of water surrounded by a membrane, right? Now, what happens when you take a pin and you pop the plastic of the balloon? Same exact thing, right? It pops and it's no longer in it, okay? So what happens, it rapidly forms these pores which cause an imbalance in the osmotic pressure, causing implosion of the cell, exactly like the water balloon underwater. All it has to do is contact the surface cell membrane and connect to these pores and pop. It causes this reaction to undergo. Okay, is PNC approved by the FDA? This is from their website, the PNC27 educational website. Regulatory approval by the United States Food and Drug Administration requires a multi-million dollar financial investment. To put that into perspective, also, there's another doctor, which I'm not even getting into tonight. I can't think of his name now. The guy that's on all the videos. What was it? It's not Berkowitz. Brzezinski. Dr. Brzezinski has a treatment that he developed. Okay, and they're in the process too of trying to raise these millions of dollars to try to get the drug approved after being shut down by the FDA and raided and everything else multiple times, trying to shut them down for using an unprescribed drug. He's trying to go through the process, but it literally costs so much that who's the only ones that can afford it? Drug companies, big pharmaceutical companies. So, although research continues on the PNC proteins today, major pharmaceutical companies have chosen not to engage in the support of these products. Why?
They don't make money on it.
Because they don't own it. It's simple. Until they can own it, they're not going to. And if they do own it, likely it won't go into production. because there's so much money being made by the cancer industry, that's it's pretty much untouchable right now. Okay? So as a result, the PNC family of proteins has not yet been approved by the FDA. Big surprise, right? Okay. Administered via intravenous, nebulizer, or suppository, depending on the cancer. So, of course, the whole purpose in the PNC is it has to come in contact with the cancer. So, depending on where it is, if you've got a lump in your throat, you use a cream and you put it on your throat. If you've got colon or rectal cancer, you use a suppository to get it in direct contact with those tissues. It just depends on where they're trying to get it to. If it's deep, they may use intravenous to get it into the bloodstream so that it carries around. It's really just a logical point of contact thing where we need to get it in contact with the cancer itself, okay? What it does is it causes an increase in blood labs of lactate dehydrogenase and bilirubin, which are signs of cancer cell destruction. So when you take your blood labs, you see these signs that usually, you know, we look for these signs when we're trying to find damage to the body, okay? If you have a severe injury where you damage lots of tissues in your body, for example, a severe burn or broken bone or something like that, you might see these levels increase because of the destruction of cells. And so we see that as, oh, that's a bad thing. But in this case, you're actually causing cancer cells specifically to go through the process of implosion, thereby raising these levels. And you'll see those happen for a number of months before they'll start to level out. Your body starts to regulate the amounts that are free throughout the system. Cancer cells do not develop resistance as they do with chemotherapy. They found that it does not develop a resistance. Chemotherapy drugs, you can only use some of these, you know, and for a while, and then the body just doesn't respond to them anymore. And so some people may go through multiple different chemotherapies before they find something that works for them, or you know, they'll go through multiple different chemotherapies and find that they develop resistance and it doesn't work anymore, and now they're metastasizing anyways. This is the first one that does not show any level of resistance because the cells don't have time to. They implode as soon as the pores are created, okay? It's the only therapy known to date that kills cancer stem cells. Okay, think about this for a second. If you've got a tumor, how does a tumor start? Stem cells, right? So you've got the stem cells, and then as that cancer begins to proliferate, it begins to expand out around there. Well, a lot of these, while chemotherapy drugs and radiation, they can kill the morphed cells of the tumor, they're not effective in killing the cancer stem cells themselves. So what happens is you go through all this tumor destruction, and then at some point there may not be any tumor left, but what you do instead is you spread cancer stem cells to now go throughout the body. And then what happens? 5 years later, you see you have metastasis into other organs. That's because the cancer cells are no longer contained. The stem cells have now been proliferated throughout. That's why all the studies, you'll notice that they use 5-year survival rates. Okay, 5-year survival rates is a tricky way of making the research look good. What they do is that if you're not familiar with this, if you live from the time of diagnosis to your day of death is 5 years in one day, you are considered a cure from cancer, statistically. Even though you're dead, you were cured. That's crazy. Okay, now think about this. Why then, this is an obvious question, I don't even have to ask it as a question. You can see why there's such a major push for early detection, right? They always say it's all about early detection. We need to get everybody screened early. Screen early, screen early, screen early. Because how do you make the research look even better? You find it earlier. Because if your timeline is this long from the time, you know, from the time of diagnosis to the time of death, but you can extend that back to here by diagnosing it far earlier, well then the 5-year mark is only here. You live a little bit longer, we can call you a cure now. You see how that works? Mm-hmm. So, you know, but rationally, we all know that a cure really means you're cured. It means that you don't have it come back. You know, that it is actually gone. But that's not the way the research works. PSA 27 is available to doctors, clinics, and hospitals outside the United States. So that's kind of the final verdict on this, is as of right now, you cannot get it here in the United States. And it's also pretty costly as well. A dose of, I actually have the information on this, because of course, my sister, the dosing for 64 suppositories is $1,800. So if you are taking two of them a day, it costs you $1,800 a month to be on it. Because, of course, it's not covered by insurance. And in the world of cancer, that's really not that bad. I mean, if you think about it, that's about the same as any other chemotherapy. The difference is you don't lose your hair, you don't lose your weight, you don't die. To put it bluntly, it's a radical difference between the two scenarios. So, you know, if we could get this stuff approved and get it covered in the U.S., that would be a significant victory for everybody that has access to it. I mean, you still have to have a doctor that's going to tell you that this is available. You know, so you guys have to know to tell the people that you know that this kind of stuff is available and direct them to the right information. Okay. Next one here. Rigvir Virotherapy. Here's another one. Developed by virologists in Latvia based on research dating back to the 1960s. They've been doing this research back as far as the 1960s. It's been approved there since 2004 in Latvia. So they've been using this stuff for 12 years at this point, successfully in that country, to where medical tourism for cancer treatment is actually a pretty decent industry in their country. They're very proud of this stuff. And now it's being licensed in multiple other countries. For example, of course, Cancun and Tijuana, Mexico. You can go to one of those two sites. Depending on where you are in the eastern U.S. or the western U.S., they put a clinic conveniently down south of the border. You know, so, you know, it's kind of funny that we have to do that, but that's how it is. You can read more of the history on Wikipedia, on all the information, where it's come from, its history, who owns it, et cetera, et cetera. It has approved all clinical trials and is fully approved in Europe, again, not in the United States. So they've gone through all the processes. You go to Europe, you can get it in most of the European countries. You can ask your doctor for this and they can put you under this treatment. It's approved there. You know, usually you see things pretty close, you know, I mean, Mexico, U.S., maybe not so much, but I mean, if it's approved in Europe, you would expect it to be approved in the United States. But this is one of those cases where it's not, and they're not apparently even looking into it at this point. There's an ebook with all the scientific data. There's a link there that you can get on later, and you can look, download that ebook and look at all the different data available. But I'm going to go through some of it. Of course, you can see it comes from an injection. Okay, this virus. Basically, of all the viruses that they studied at this lab, they found the one that was the least likely to cause human disease. Okay, and then once they found that virus that was the least likely to cause a problem, then they tweaked the genes of it in order to make it do what they wanted to and specifically target cancer cells only. Okay? So it's oncotropic, means it attacks cancer cells, leaving healthy cells completely unharmed. It does not replicate inside of normal healthy cells. Only cells that have particular receptor sites will it attack. Once it attacks them, it's oncolytic. It goes into the cell, it penetrates the cancer cell wall, it replicates like viruses do inside of the cell, until there's no more to consume, and then it lyses open the cell, causing itself to send troops out throughout the rest of the body to now find what? More cancer cells. So you turn one into an army of hundreds or thousands or however that works to go out and seek out new cells and destroy those. But it is oncolytic, it does break down those cells. It also tends to unmask the tumor's hiding characteristics. So this is a really interesting one. Because tumors and cancer, they have the ability to mask themselves from the immune system. Essentially, the immune system does not recognize that they're there. And that's a big problem in, you know, because of course your immune system now won't target the tissues. It leaves it alone. It just, it walks right past it. But they found that when they use this, and the rigvir actually marks the cell, all of a sudden the immune system somehow knows that that cell is there. I don't know if it's because it recognizes the virus and it goes to where the virus is. I don't think they know. You know, who knows? But they can show, there are photographs showing, and I think it might actually be on the next slide, the cells surrounded by immune cells after administration of this drug. And it is a drug. I mean, this is not a natural substance. It is a medication. Okay, but it will actually cause the immune system to identify. Now you have both the rigvir doing this thing, but you also have your immune system going after those cells and tissues as well. It's a remarkable thing. Okay, patients with regional lymph node metastases had 75% survival compared to only 21% survival who received conventional treatments only. That's in the studies. 75% compared to 21%. So if you were diagnosed with cancer and you went to your doctor and he gave you an option of 75% or 21%, what do you think you'd go for? You know, it's pretty obvious, right? And so, you know, it makes you really question, once again, why are we not fast-tracking this stuff through? Maybe it will. You know, we're about to have a new government, right? Maybe it will get fast-tracked through, but, you know, it's too early to know any of that. All right, rigvir is not a vaccine. Okay, this is rigvir in action here. We'll go through this in a second, but rigvir is not a vaccine. A lot of times, anytime people see an injection, they automatically think, oh, it's a vaccine, especially now because we have the Gardasil vaccine that's sold to people as a cancer vaccine, which is complete and total baloney. It is not a cancer prevention vaccine. That is such a stretch of the imagination, it's ridiculous. If you look at the research, it's bogus. I don't know how they can get away with that kind of communication to the public, yet a chiropractor or a naturopath can't say that they cure skin infections. Yeah, I mean, it's ridiculous. You know, there's more evidence, obviously, in this way, yet they're allowed to get on and they're allowed to say whatever they want to. So vaccines are able to actually cause a disease that they are intended to prevent. Rigvir cannot. They've designed this to where it does not cause any disease in a human. Again, they use the mildest virus that they could isolate. It's actually a normally occurring virus that is in children, I think they said, between the ages of 8 and 12. So it's just a normal virus that you never knew existed that doesn't do any harm to pretty much anybody that you never heard of. And that's what they use as the carrier, if you will. Okay, vaccines are also stored with toxic adjuvants like mercury and aluminum. You know, mercury may have been taken out of a lot of the childhood vaccines, but that's not even the problem. The aluminum is a much bigger issue. If you guys haven't looked into this, I have multiple studies on my website that are linked out to, for example, one from MIT that shows the mechanism of injury with aluminum toxicity and its relationship to autism. You know, yet these things are not being talked about. Aluminum is a much, much more dangerous adjuvant. While healthy cells have developed ways to fight off viruses, cancer cells have not. This is a really interesting, we're going to stop and ponder on this for a second. While healthy cells have developed ways to fight off viruses, cancer cells have not. Many normal cells have a complicated network of molecules to help protect against a virus. But it turns out cancer cells are deficient and antiviral factors. Okay, this was Howard Kaufman, who is actually designing a similar product in the United States using the herpes virus. Okay, so they're finding that they can do this with all kinds of different viruses. Now, dissect what he's saying there, because I think this is radically important that even, you know, maybe he doesn't even get what he's saying here, but a vitalist reads this very different. Okay, healthy cells have developed ways to fight off viruses. How have they done that? By catching them, right? Develops this ability, normal ability, because it's having to fight off infections as you go. Okay, Many normal cells have a complicated network of molecules to protect against, but turns out cancer cells are deficient. Now, this raises a really interesting question that kind of ties all this in together, because I want you to ponder something. They are currently researching measles, herpes, polio, of course, you know, the Riga virus. They've researched all these viruses, and they're finding that they have oncotropic properties. In other words, these viruses have the ability to increase your resistance to cancer. And that's why they're looking at them. So now, what does that immediately make you think about? These are all things that we vaccinate for. Okay? Might I propose a possibility, might I say preposterous possibility, that if we weren't vaccinating for all these things and we were allowing our bodies to create a natural defense to them, not die from these incurable, awful viruses, but the way most people get the viruses, they get them, nothing happens, they're sick for a few days, they get over it like the flu, right? What happened if we did that? We focused on actually getting people's immune systems healthy to where they could survive these things without problem. That's what we should be focusing on. But we allow nature and its exposures to take its course the way that it should be, so that we're building the resistance to these things. And maybe through this weird off-the-wall connection, we wouldn't see as much cancer. I know it's preposterous, right? But is it possible? You know, someday we will find out. Someday we'll know the truth. Okay, as for the rig gear for now, rig gear in action, this is how rig gear affects melanoma cells. In the first one here, you see melanoma cells before application of the rig gear. In the second one, you see cells from the same patient after several courses of rig gear start showing apoptotic tumor cells, lymphocytes, which is the immune system attacking the area, and plasma cells. This image shows a melanoma cell that's surrounded by recruited lymphocytes after the rig gear application. So these are all white blood cells attacking that cancer cell after the treatment that, you know, this cell is supposed to be masked, right? But apparently now the body knows that it's there, okay?
We spend our lives among viruses. Latvian scientists have succeeded in taming one of the viruses to make it work for the benefit of mankind. Meet Rigvir, the virus that knows how to fight cancer. It is a unique, live, oncolytic virus with immunomodulating activity. Virotherapy implies the use of oncotropic and oncolytic viruses in oncology. Rigvir is the first registered oncolytic virus in the field of cancer virotherapy. Rigvir is delivered by intramuscular injections. After Rigvir enters the body, it finds cancer cells and infects them. Rigvir replicates within the cancer cells until they collapse. Then the virus finds other cancer cells. Rigvir does not infect healthy cells. Rigvir acts immediately. Rigvir is used in treating different cancer types and sarcoma of different types. Rigvir efficiency and safety have been tested on several thousand patients. Rigvir does not cause adverse events. Subfebrile temperature for 1 to 3 days and fatigue have been observed. Rigvir is well tolerated and improves quality of life. Virotherapy with Rigvir has several advantages. The treatment is assigned according to developed indications and under strict supervision of doctors. To develop virotherapy and provide real help to cancer patients, the International Virotherapy Center was established in 2008 in Latvia. The Virotherapy Center ensures full service for patients 24/7, cooperation and development, and cross-border medicine. The International Virotherapy Center educates and issues certificates to doctors and provides accreditation to medical institutions. With the help of cross-border medicine, virotherapy is available for every person, regardless the place of his or her residence. Every month, the number of certified virotherapists and accredited clinics is growing. the Latvian Academy of Sciences has acknowledged Rigvir as one of the most outstanding scientific inventions. You are welcome to receive more information about virotherapy with Rigvir in the International Virotherapy Centre.
So once again, like we asked the question, 75 versus what, 21%, what would you choose? Mm-hmm. So a sub-febrile temperature versus losing your hair, which one would you choose? And the answer is obvious, right? So unless you really don't like haircuts, I mean, it could be convenient. Okay, next one, sonophotodynamic therapy, okay? In this process, another really interesting process, a porphyrin substance known as SP activate is used, which is taken out by cancer cells 70 to 1. Okay, so what they do is this porphyrin, cancer cells are hungry. So they take up this particular chemical at a rate of 70 to 1 to normal healthy cells. So they're swallowing up the vast majority of what you put into the body. Okay, so once they take this in, then they use an ultrasound and pulsed LED laser at 440 nanometers, 660, and near-infrared to activate. Okay, and at that point, what it does, once in the cell, the sonophototherapy energy causes release of an active form of oxygen. And what have you guys probably heard in the past about oxygen in regards to cancer cells? They don't like each other, right? So the oxygenated environment tends to cause the cancer to die. That destroys the nearby cells. Well, is this completely indiscriminate like the other two? You know, where it's going to leave healthy cells completely alone? Well, no, not entirely. But it's a 70 to 1 process. So the vast majority of the damaged tissues are going to be cancer sites. But you have a 1, you know, compared to the 70, that is going to be healthy cells that may be damaged as well. But that's where your body and its remarkable ability to heal comes into play, because it can deal with that part while you're aggressively dealing with the stuff that is not supposed to be there. So it is also effective. It's found to be in damaging the blood vessels in the tumor, effectively starving it. So this environment also creates this neoangiogenesis. It breaks all those vessels down, which of course supply the nutrients and the oxygen to the cancer cells in order to survive. So when you cut off their blood supply, it's like cutting off a supply line to the front lines of a military campaign. It no longer works, right? It all falls apart on its own. So you can see the process here, the way that they use the light energy, sound energy into the cancer cells. Really interesting process. This is one of the side therapies that they also do at the Hope for Cancer Clinic down in Mexico. Okay, speaking of, this is Dr. Antonio Jimenez. He's the lead doctor that created the Hope for Cancer Clinic. Of the first 55 patients, that all data has been collected. Okay, so this was from a video that was in like 2014, you know, that they had this video. Well, obviously a couple more years have gone by since that time, and they've expanded their clinic since that time, but they had 55 patients that they had collected all the data that they needed to put this information together, okay? And of all that, 82% of the entering patients were stage 4 cancer. Now, what do you know about stage 4 cancer? That's typically when the conventional doctors tell you there's nothing left that we can do. It's game over at this point. So stage 4 is really where we're just trying to keep you comfortable, you know, and we know 6 months, maybe a year, you know, it's just not a good situation. Well, 82% of these entering patients were stage 4. Now think about how did that happen? Well, it's simple. Most of these patients had gone through conventional therapy. Mm-hmm. And when that didn't work, they started looking to the absurd options like going down south across the border into Mexico, right? So at that point, they take them and they put them under care. Now, I wonder how the situation might be different if they hadn't undergone all the conventional treatments first. Because as one ex-FDA commissioner said, the miracle is not that the patient survives cancer, is that they survive cancer and the treatments. Okay, so it might be a little bit different. Yet, regardless of those facts, 91% of the patients reported their quality of life improved or did not worsen. 91%. Can you say that about the cancer ward down the street? Any of them? No. 71% of the patients reported improvement or no worsening in overall health condition. Who in here has seen the bucket list? You guys, if you haven't seen that movie, I don't want to say fantastic scene. It's an awful scene, but it's a scene where Jack Nicholson and who is the other guy?
Morgan Freeman.
You know, they start their chemotherapy treatments at the same time, and it shows like this, you know, this like 7 or 8 minute segment of them just going back and forth, having relentless nights of puking and everything else, and just life falling apart. You know, so yeah, 71% of the patients here reported improvement or no worsening in overall health condition at all. Okay, 11 of these patients had palpable tumors. They were so large that they could actually feel them. And yet 64% of these reported palpable changes by the time that they left. They could actually feel the tumor shrinking and changing in its consistency, okay? Which we're gonna hear more about tonight as well. Okay, next one, the NORI protocol. Okay, this is another one that's kind of gaining some traction out there in the quasi-scientific realm, right? The UCLA research in 1974 discovered an absolute methionine deficiency of some forms of metastatic cancer. In other words, some cancer, you guys have all heard that cancer survives off of sugar, right? Well, they found this research they know it has to have methionine to survive. These certain forms of cancer, you must have methionine. So that led to some interesting thoughts and processes. So restrict high methionine foods and consume plenty of fresh raw fruits is what this particular protocol calls for. And a lot of people have had great success with it. A lot of people have seen their conditions radically improve. So the interesting thing about this is that they tell you to eat plenty of fresh raw fruit. Now, if you consider that compared to the conventional methods out there, the typical alternative, you know, most doctors will tell you if you have cancer, don't eat any fruit whatsoever. And guess what? I was one of those. I said, don't eat any fruit whatsoever because of the sugar, because that's what we knew. But the new research that is going to be changing the way that we instruct moving forward to deal with metabolic conditions, not cancer, because I don't treat cancer, but to get the patient back to health and deal with metabolic syndrome, okay, then you should eat lots of fruits, because there is the ability of fruits to cause an alkaline environment. There is there is energy in fruits. This is amazing. If you actually link 4 lemons together without any power source, you link 4 lemons together and then put an LED chip in between them and connect them together, you know what it lights up the LED? Figure that one out, right? They know that there is an energy to living foods, okay? The real interesting thing about all this is, you know, they tell you to restrict high methionine foods, which is beef, dairy, chicken, any kind of meat whatsoever, which ties into the whole other group that tells you that meat consumption is the absolute cause of cancer, and that if you want to be cancer-free, you have to go vegan, right? Mm-hmm. There's that whole other group. Well, this is where some of these thoughts start to tie in together, because they are right on some of this stuff. You know, there is a consistency with it. But I'm not sure it's the same as what they're looking at, because all the research that we've ever looked at on beef and cows, you know, et cetera, on looking at meat, we're always studying conventional cows. Well, what do conventional cows eat? Corn and grains. That's all they eat. They don't eat grass. I mean, if you look at a grass-fed cow, its omega balance is 4-1. If you look at a corn-fed cow, it's like 20-1. That's a radical difference. Mm. So, you know, that whole principle of you are what you eat is right. Well, you are what, you know, you get what you study. And if you study cows that eat corn all day, you're going to get a very different picture from if you study healthy, functional cows. Okay, so now when we look at this a little bit closer, going back methionine was discovered as being a major issue with feedlots, whether it's chicken, I mean, particularly poultry, but anytime you're raising animals, when you have them in small confines and they don't have areas to forage and graze and everything, they don't have adequate, they don't develop adequate levels of methionine, and so they don't grow. So they discovered that if they supplement methionine into their diets, that it makes their populations grow, and it makes them grow very fast, especially with chickens, right? They grow very fast. Well, real methionine is expensive, and it's hard to come by, right? Because it's made in nature. So what do? They make synthetic methionine, and it brings the price way down, and it's cheap, okay? So if you look at, for example, this natural, you know, methionine compound, not to pick on any particular one, but it says a unique combination of herbal methyl rep and synthetic DL sources of methionine. Okay? Now, synthetic methionine is commonly added to conventional feeds despite the evidence that they can obtain sufficient natural methionine while foraging pastures. That study was done in 2005. But the problem is they're not foraging pastures. Mm-hmm. Now, if you buy cattle from a good source that you know, or you raise them, you don't have to worry about any of this. That's the whole point, is you're not going to be getting the synthetic methionine. You can control it. However, synthetic methionine is even still allowed under USA regulations in organic poultry. No limits are in place. They don't allow the same amounts in organic poultry, but guess what? You're buying organic meats, unless you know where they're coming from, you're still getting this stuff. And we don't know the full picture here. We don't know the consequences. But I can tell you, just like we find in all this other stuff, I couldn't find any research on it besides one. I found a study that looked at chickens, and they were looking at natural methionine versus synthetic, and they found that basically growth and everything else were pretty much on target. As long as they were getting methionine, that those markers were all the same. But they saw elevated triglycerides and I think elevated cardiovascular issues with the synthetic group. And that was it. That's all I could find. I mean, I looked around for probably a good hour trying to find studies that looked at, is there a difference between the two? I don't know that they've been done. You know, so we're using this stuff and throwing it into even organic feeds, and we don't know what the consequences are yet. The concept, you know, that you connect the dots, it points back to these major issues, which, you know, everybody always says, we don't know the cause. Well, there's lots of causes, but this looks like this could be an issue. So once again, get away from the synthetic stuff, and we need to be eating natural foods. If you don't know for sure, it's probably best to just stay off of it. You know, especially if you know you're diagnosed. If you have cancer, stop eating methionine, period. I mean, if you don't know if it's in there, just don't eat meat at all. Go vegan. Now, that's fine. So, next one, the Hoxie herbs. Who in here has heard of Harold Hoxie? Okay, Dr. Hoxie is implicated as potentially the biggest huckster in the history of American medicine, right? That's at least what you'll find on Wikipedia and such. So this doctor, this man, I don't know that even he was even a doctor. He owned an oil field in Texas. His family had big oil money. And so he didn't need any money, okay? He did not need the money. But his father noticed that he had a cow that had cancer, or a cow or a horse, I don't remember which one it was, doesn't matter, but it had cancer, they knew it, and it went out and it started eating in a different area of the field, and its cancer disappeared, it went away. And so that was the story, whether it was true or false, doesn't matter. These were the herbs that they used in his formula, okay? They used red clover, licorice, buckthorn, burdock, Stalingia, poke root, barberry, Oregon grapefruit, cascara, prickly ash, wild indigo, and potassium iodide, which is iodine. Okay, pay attention to that one too. It was a high level of iodine. Okay, so this was the base formula that developed into 17 clinics around the United States. Okay, now, I mean, I know he had a lot of money, But if he wasn't, you know, any businessman that isn't making money probably isn't spending a lot of money. I mean, you guys know Donald Trump didn't spend as much money as he said he was going to spend on his campaign, partially because he probably didn't think he was going to win, right? But that's the way business people think. They invest in what they're in what the situations look like moving forward. Okay, so I doubt he just threw out all of his money to put 17 clinics in 17 different states. Yet it happened. So what does that tell you? It was probably working. And when you look at the evidence behind it, if you look at the following that he created, it looked like it worked. Okay, they were the largest network of cancer clinics in the U.S. until the editor of the Journal of the American Medical Association, after confronting him and wanting to buy his research and buy the access to his product, in which he denied and said, no, you'll put it on a shelf somewhere. Then they went after him and got them kicked out of the United States and moved down to Mexico. So that's a short story. You can read more about it later. But we found a similar product that is called Baseline Nutritionals Blood Sports, which if you look at the ingredients, they're strikingly familiar, okay? The good thing is about the way that information is nowadays, the way that research is nowadays, we can concentrate things in herbal formulas much better than he could back at those times. So you get much cleaner products, much better concentration, just better quality control standards, and this product is actually sold by a medical doctor. Now, is this a cancer treatment? The answer is no. Obviously, it says right on the label, it's blood support and it's a dietary supplement, a natural blood cleanser and powerful antipathogen, so it is not a cancer treatment, okay? But strikingly familiar. I mean, it's got a lot of interesting connections. Red clover, chaparral, burdock, poke root, yellow dock, golden seal, Oregon grape, bloodroot, mistletoe, cat's claw, sheep sorrel, cayenne. Now on that note, you notice one in there is bloodroot. There's another product on the market called Black Salve, okay? Now, Black Salve, if you do a little bit of research on this, you can find some not so great information on it. Now, on that note, I have seen patients that have decided on their own merit to use it and have seen good results, and I've witnessed it. I've seen it work, right? Some of us have personal experience with that, but it is very aggressive. It's an escharotic herb, which means it excavates into the tissues. Okay, so there's also cases where if you get online, whether these are free cases or not, you know, you see pictures of where people have put it on their nose and their nose is like completely gone, you know, and I know other people that have gotten scars and stuff like that from trying to use it. So the good thing is about the blood support, I've never seen any of those kind of reactions with it. I mean, when people have chosen to use this as an alternative, for whatever moles and such, I've never seen them have a reaction to it. So, you know, it appears to be much, much less aggressive. So you should take careful judgment before using these, and of course, with any of these. You know, I mean, it's always got to be your best judgment. And of course, ask your doctor before taking any of these, right? Okay, liposomal vitamin C. It's cheaper than intravenous vitamin C, hands down. Okay, liposomal vitamin C is much, much cheaper. Intravenous vitamin C can be $200 a treatment, okay? Yet you can buy all the equipment and make your first 10 batches for $200, okay? It's really inexpensive to make. Livon Labs, their lipospheric vitamin C is the most popular available for purchase. However, there is ample criticism out there about the quality of this because liposomes are naturally somewhat unstable and so they're hard to keep intact. And the only way that they work is when they're intact. So what happens is you take vitamin C and you encapsulate it in a lecithin shell, if you will. Okay? Then when you ingest it, the lecithin shell protects the vitamin C while it goes through your gut until the pancreatic acids start to break it all down. Then your body identifies the vitamin C that's now been hatched, and it grabs it and pulls it into the bloodstream, and you get immediate access into the bloodstream. Which, I mean, you can, when you use this stuff, a lot of times you can feel the buzz from the increased oxygenation and everything to your brain. I mean, it's pretty remarkable. Some neat stuff. Like I said, so because of that, I don't know that I'm necessarily a fan of that based on what I've read, though I will tell you the Hope for Cancer Clinic, the Live on Labs, is what they recommend. That's what they actually give to their patients. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's for ease or what, but, you know, to each his own. There's a great web link including the patent purchased by Live on Labs on how to easily make liposomes without fancy equipment. Okay, so some brilliant scientists realize that it's really easy to make liposomes that are intact, that are complete, that are stable, and their process basically is like a blender and distilled water and a little bit of alcohol. And the alcohol helps it to all stay together. But of course, this is a patented process, so while you can get on and you can read about how to make it, you can't sell it. Okay, you know, and I can't condone you make it yourself, but you know, you're welcome to the information. So now our non-patented recipe, which does not include the alcohol in the process, you take 3/4 cup of acerola cherry powder and 32 ounces of distilled water. You then mix in a separate container 3/4 of a cup of sunflower, organic sunflower lecithin granules, and 32 ounces of distilled water. So you blend these two separate, then you pour the two together into an ultrasonic cleaner that you can buy from Harbor Freight for like $60, right? One of the big jewelry cleaners. The good news is you can make it gold shine again once you're done. So you put it in there, you mix it with a wooden spoon because, you know, the wood doesn't vibrate the way that a metal spoon would. So you mix it with a wooden spoon for 15 to 18 minutes. And that process of shaking the lecithin and the acerola cherry powder, which is a very, very potent and natural form of vitamin C, it makes the encapsulations in the presence. You have to have water. That's actually one of the criticisms of this one, is when you break it, when you open up the package, it's very gooey, it's very jelly. Mercola's liposomal vitamin C has also gotten very bad reviews, basically saying that the science doesn't match up to what's in the package because it's a gel substance, and you have to have a very watery suspension in order to maintain liposomes. Okay? Yes?
How many doses will your recipe make?
Well, it depends on how much you take. So this would be 64 ounces. A typical dose is an ounce. You know, so you would have more than your family would require if you make this. And the good thing is you can break down this. You of course could do a 1/4 cup in a 1/3 of the 32 ounces, you know, so about 10 ounces of water. And, you know, you would just make a smaller dose.
Keep it refrigerated?
Yes, keep it refrigerated. It'll actually last longer. But even that, the ones that came up with this process say it only lasts for about, really ideally, 7 days, 10 days. It's best in the first 3 days. You know, in other words, the longer you let it sit there, the more it's going to degrade and break down. Make sense? Okay. So looking at this picture here, what do you see is wrong with this? Yeah, this is, of course, probably zucchini plants by the looks of it. This is some kind of squash. Okay, and are these healthy plants or are they sick plants? Okay, so when we look at a sick plant like this, what do we immediately think? I mean, if you're a gardener, you think it's lacking something. There's something missing. It might be water, it might be air, it might be sunlight, it might be one of those other seven homeostatic essentials, right, in human understanding. So it's lacking something. Now, is it a good idea, if you're a gardener, to go to the store and buy the most toxic crap you can buy? Oh, sorry, I can't say that on Facebook, right? Buy this stuff and just dump it on the plant. Let's see if that'll overtake it, right? Let's see if that'll, maybe it'll shock it back to life, right? You know, I mean, what if there's bugs around? I mean, let's say some beetles are chewing off the base of it. We could pour a little gasoline on there, fry up some beetles. You know, I mean, that sounds like a good idea. You know, any gardener would look at these and like, no, that's, it's not, you know, cancer is not a disease. It's something that we're developing. And a lot of these are leading back to nutritional deficiencies, just basic fundamental nutritional deficiencies in combination of exposure to toxins. That's what we're coming to. Okay, one of these big ones that nobody is talking about, I mean, we've been talking about it for years now, but I still don't see this buzzing around the media, is iodine deficiency. You can go back to our workshop if you haven't watched it, the deficient workshop on YouTube. Go back and watch that again, because I go through all this information on why everybody is iodine deficient. What were the steps that were taken in place by the government, etc., to remove it from our food supply. Okay, so go back and watch that. It's really fascinating. But here's the evidence. Evidence is substantial of necessity links to cancer and epidemic deficiencies. There's a whole list of articles on that link there. You can go back and you can look through those. Iodine deficiency is associated with a higher rate of goiter, which, you know, that's when your thyroid blows up, right? And breast cancer. Japan has the highest dietary intake of iodine and the lowest rates of goiter and breast cancer. When they move to the United States, breast cancer rates increase. Wonder where the connection is, right? Iceland, previous to World War I, used fish meal feed for dairy cows, providing milk with high iodine content. After World War I, fish meal was eliminated and breast cancer rates soared tenfold. These are just historical studies that, I mean, we know the information, it's there. Now we have a situation in the United States where not only do we not get it in our food supply, but we add bromine in its place to all of our food, all of our wheat products, they're all brominated. When you look at a loaf of bread, you'll see it says brominated wheat flour. That means that they're adding into it an iodine antagonizer. It actually competes with iodine so that you don't get iodine absorption in your body because you're toxic with bromine. Also, fluoride. Fluoride is added to our water supply. Our dentists give us fluoride, right? And that is also a toxic halide that competes with iodine. So all of these issues compound into pretty much everybody being iodine deficient, okay? The Shivastava group in India reported molecular iodine induces apoptosis in human breast cancer cell cultures, okay? The Carmen Cevas Velasco group in Mexico found iodine binds to membrane lipids called lactones, forming iodolactones, which regulate apoptosis, which is cell death. That's when the cancer cells explode, they detonate. They concluded that continuous molecular iodine treatment has a potent anti-neoplastic effect on progression of mammary cancer. Then Dr. Funahashi in Japan reported a common seaweed containing high iodine to be more beneficial than chemotherapy on breast cancer. So, and then what was one of the big bases for Dr. Hoxie's formula? Potassium iodide. Okay, there are links all over the place with this, and it's just common sense, because a very small percentage of your body's total iodine is actually used by your thyroid. I'll get to your question. When you go to the doctor and you get your thyroid hormones tested, which they typically look at to see if the thyroid is operating, your thyroid gland gets first dibs on your iodine. It is required there first. So your thyroid is going to take all the iodine it possibly can, yet all the other tissues in your body require it also. So your thyroid can be fine getting enough to create and churn out enough hormones to make it look like you're doing okay, yet the rest of your body is completely deficient, starving, including the mammary glands, which, you know, of course, is the link with breast cancer. Yes?
That kind of has to do with my question. I was going to ask, does iodine deficiency just link with thyroid and breast cancer, or can that link with other cancers as well?
That's what they've studied so far that I looked at, but no, there are actually, on the first link that I showed you on this page here, you can see there is actually links with other forms of cancer also. But of course, they're only going to find what they look for. That's a problem with research, is you only know what you actually look for. So, you know, if it truly is a connection with iodine deficiency, they're going to know at some point, you know, and they will find it. We okay there, Amber?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So we always recommend to all of our patients, we do some basic tests. We do the simple ones that are just honestly cheap to do, the iodine patch test and the morning temperatures test, which are validated by a number of, most medical doctors. It's mostly medical doctors that came up with these procedures, just in case there's any questioning of those, of the quality of those tests. But we do those tests in advance, and then we usually recommend people take the TMI from systemic formulas and then switch to the iodine synergy later once their thyroid is working properly and we know that there's no issues. But this maintains proper iodine levels, so you're getting it as a regular part of your diet because you're just not in your diets. Okay, so I definitely recommend, if you guys have not looked at this, if you're not taking it on a regular basis, you need to reconsider it and, talk to me, watch workshops on that, start digging into the research here because it's radically important. Okay, next one, omega-3 deficiency. The cell membrane is actually the nerve system of the cell. This bilipid layer creates the outside membrane of the cell. And so this is where all intracellular and extracellular communication happens. Okay, again, what is the problem with cancer? The cells are not in communication and coordination with the other tissues and cells around them. Where does that process happen? At the cell membrane. Okay, so this is the nerve system of the cell. Combination of chemotherapy and omega-3 supplementation appears an effective strategy to enhance the clinical outcome of cancer patients. You don't say. Omega-3 fatty acids are thought to reduce inflammation in the body, and a variety of cancers have been linked to chronic inflammation. This was the senior dietitian at MD Anderson. You don't say, right? We know, we hear inflammation all the time. We know that omega fatty acids are one of the best substances to modulate inflammation in the body. It's one of the only substances, I think it is the only one, that regulates both the COX and LOX mechanisms of inflammation in the body. So, we really have to, you don't have to go very far to find medical doctors now screaming everybody needs to be taking fish oils, right? You guys have seen this smeared all over the place. And you've also seen some studies trying to knock it down too, right? I wonder where that comes from. Populations in countries that consume high amounts of omega-3 fatty acids from fish have lower incidences of breast cancer and colon cancer, breast, prostate, and colon cancer than people in countries that consume less omega-3s. Again, very, very obvious. So they form this layer in between the cells to keep the inside of the cell, the water inside the cell, away from the water outside the cell, just like the balloon example that we gave you with inside of a bucket of water. Okay, the next one, vitamin D deficiency. Vitamin D3 with vitamin K is the immune system activator. It actually tells the immune system it's a hormone. It's not really a vitamin. It's a hormone that tells the body what to do and creates all kinds of different processes, sets off a chain of responses. But overall, we found a 30% reduction of all-cause mortality associated with vitamin D levels at the time of diagnosis. So if they find high levels of vitamin D in the patients at diagnosis, they do better. Go figure, right? A PubMed database search yielded 63 observational studies of vitamin D status in relation to cancer risk. The majority of studies found a protective relationship between sufficient vitamin D status and lower risk of cancer. The evidence suggests that efforts to improve vitamin D status, for example, by vitamin D supplementation, specifically D3, I would say, a lot of doctors are giving D2, which then has to be processed by the liver, which creates an additional burden on you. So use D3. It could reduce cancer incidence and mortality at low cost with few or no adverse effects. So why in the heck is Medicare and Medicaid not doing this? If we really want to cut down on our medical costs, if we're, if the government is supposed to be responsible for our healthcare costs, this is a cheap and easy way to do it. But they're not doing it, right? They're not prescribing and giving people, across the board, requiring that you take vitamin D in order to have access to free healthcare, right? But these are simple steps that we really should be putting into action. This is an interesting map. When you look at this, They look at, this is the estimated vitamin D serum levels and projected percentage prevention of colon cancer cases with just 2,000 IUs of vitamin D3 and 3 to 10 minutes daily of noon sunlight seasonally when weather permits. What you see on this chart is basically right at the equator where the sun is the highest, you see the best rates. And as you go away from the equator into these different countries, you see that the cancer rates increase. Okay? They know there's some kind of a link there. They you know, vitamin D is maybe somewhat too obvious, but they know there's links there, and the science is just growing and growing and growing out there on this topic. Go to PubMed and look up vitamin D research, and you'll find all kinds of stuff on this. So it's a no-brainer. Just do it. Okay? Dr. Sebi, this is someone else turned me on to this guy, and unfortunately he was actually killed this year, died, I'm sorry, did I say killed? He died this year. He was 80-something years old, 82 years old. He was had a clinic in Honduras where they took patients and cured them in Honduras. You know, you can do that there. Then he also came to the U.S. and he did work in the U.S. and he was teaching that, you know, they took his clinic, I think it was in New York, and back in the 1980s or something, he put in the newspapers that he could cure herpes, AIDS, cancer, and a couple of other diseases and put them in a publication. Well, of course, what happened?
He died.
Yeah. It ended up going all the way to the Supreme Court. No, he didn't die yet. we wouldn't do that. It went to the Supreme Court, and he beat the Supreme Court. Okay, he had 70 plus patients with all of their records and in attendance, showing that they were absolutely cured of those diseases before and afters. So they release him of all charges, and we're like, okay, well, I guess you cure these things. Okay. Well, anyways, long story short, he ended up getting put in a prison in horrific conditions earlier this year, and where a healthy guy went in, he died of pneumonia in that prison, and nobody really knows the exact details of what happened beyond that. So it was not in the United States, though, right? It was in another country that this happened. Yeah, somewhere he was traveling through, and you know, he probably had like a, you know, some illegal herb in his pocket, or you know, who knows. But anyways, here is all the information. I'm not going to read through all this because some of it I can't even pronounce. Like, does anybody know what phonio is? I've never heard of it. But this is his list of acceptable foods. Okay, and his whole premise makes sense. His whole premise is that mucus congestion is a cause of disease in the human body. That when you consume foods and you're exposed to toxins that create a mucus response in the body, which you probably heard some of this before, that it causes disease depending on where that mucus congestion is, whether it's heart failure or pneumonia or laryngitis or whatever. It's all about mucus. And what do you see when you're sick? What just happens? Mucus, right? Okay, and so his whole process is about breaking down mucus in the body. And how do you do that? He was the pioneer of the alkaline diet. His whole process and research led him to show that you bring the alkalinity of the body to a state where it actually breaks down the mucus and starts to expel it. So, of course, you know, his is also part that goes into the don't eat meat, you know, picture, because the meat, you know, he found causes mucus production. So if you are sick, you know, this might be a good diet to go after, right? So we have that on there as an option also. Rest in peace, Dr. Sebi. Good work. Okay, so this picture here, you know, is just one more example of, you know, like the garden. If we have a fish tank, you know, especially when who puts real plants in fish tanks anymore? You know, they're always the plastic things. Because, I mean, who could keep real live plants alive inside of a fish tank? She can. But if you have a fish tank and the fish tank and the fish are sick, you know, do you start throwing medications into the fish tank, hoping that something is going to get right? No, the typical answer is you measure the pH of the water. You look for bacteria counts, you look for all these things, then you take the fish out and you put it into a healthy environment, while you go and you take the other fish tank and you break it down and you clean it and you scrub everything down, you put everything in new, and then you check the pH and you balance it all out, make sure it's working, and then you put the sick fish back into the healthy fish tank, and voila, what happens? The fish usually recovers. Okay? That's the way biological systems work. Well, your body is a biological system, is it not? So when we're sick, we should be looking to the environment, both internal and external. And that's where all of this information is leading to, is that we have to consider that. So therefore, once again, I contend that the smartest idea when you're sick is not to put the most toxic poisons you can into your sick body. It just doesn't make sense. And I think obviously most people here agree, but some people, you know, are still adamant about that cause. Okay, so at this point, we're going to, is she ready? We're gonna ring in my my sister, who is, hey, we're right on time. Look at that. I thought by you guys' faces, I was way over time. All right. Hello, I can't see you. Let's see, your video is turned off. I can see us, but we can't see you. Is your camera turned on? Oh, there you go. Hey, there you go. This is my lovely sister, Julie.
Hi.
Okay. And this is my lovely crowd.
Hi.
Okay. Good to see you always. Can you guys turn up the volume on her just a little bit? Okay. You don't have to scream. We're gonna turn up the volume here. Okay, so I'm off the screen, and now I'm on the screen. Well, you can't see my forehead, so you can hear me fine. So you'll just have to talk to them. Okay, so if you can start real quick, tell them your background. Of course, you know, you're a pharmacist, et cetera. Just give them your quick background so they know who they're talking to.
Okay. Well, I went to pharmacy school because I knew that I wanted to help people, and I thought that, would be a good way to do it. So I went through 5 years of pharmacy school, and I learned some very interesting things while I was there, and it really troubled me when they talked about all of the side effects and just all of the things that went along with it. And it was never talk about what's causing something to be wrong. It's just, if this is wrong, this is the pill you give. And anyway, so I graduated. I worked in several capacities. I worked in retail. I worked in hospitals. I worked in home health care. So I did a couple different facets of the industry. And it just, I never really felt like I was helping people. I think the thing that bothered me the most was when I would have an elderly patient come in once a month with a giant gallon Ziploc bag full of empty prescription bottles. And they'd hand it to me, and they didn't know half of what they were on or why they were on it. And I remember thinking, is this all that we have to look forward to? Is this the end of our cycle? Our healthcare system is this giant bag of pills every single month. And I just thought there's got to be something. And that was kind of the beginning of my disinterest in pharmacy. Then I had kids, and on the second kid, my husband and I decided it would be best for me to stay home. So I was able to step away from it. And through the course of my kids growing up, the more I learned about the big pharmacies and just their motives and everything behind it, I just knew more and more in my gut that I could not be a part of that system anymore. It just was corrupt, and they weren't, I could really tell, and I could see that they weren't in it to heal people. They were in it to make money, and that was the bottom line. And, you know, when you're told in pharmacy school that one of the top 10 killers in the country is being on pharmaceutical drugs, not taking them the wrong way, not interactions, just being on that is in the top 10 causes of death in the United States. That sat with me, and that made me nervous and made me pause. Like, why is no one having problems with this? So that's kind of, that started my journey, and it got to the point that I let my license lapse. I just knew that ethically and morally, I could not be a part of that system anymore. I wasn't helping people.
And being as humble as
as a Bucknell is. She's not telling you how smart she really is, too. She is brilliant. You were, second in your high school class and, first in pharmacy school?
Not first, but...
No.
Yeah. I passed.
Yeah. And I got to grow up watching her have ulcers from studying, so I decided sleeping was a better option. Right? So, but we both did okay. So anyhow, let me wipe the smile off my face now. So tell them now what of course changed your life as far as when you got diagnosed and what has happened since then, up until the point that you went to decided to go to Mexico.
Okay. So 4 years ago, I my favorite show is Dancing with the Stars. And one of the ladies on there, Brooke Burke, had I saw her on a talk show, and she was talking about how she had a lump on the side of her neck. It never bothered her, but she went and had it checked out, and it turned out to be thyroid cancer. And I thought, that is really weird, because I have a lump on the side of my throat. It's never bothered me, but maybe I should check it out. So I went to the doctor, and they did an ultrasound, and they were like, I don't like it. Let's do a CAT scan. So they did a CAT scan. I don't like it. Let's do a biopsy. I did a biopsy. And on Valentine's Day, the nurse called me, and she said, I'm really sorry to tell you, but you have papillary thyroid cancer. And I just was shocked and scared and all of those emotions that you get. And I thought, how can this happen? I'm fairly young. I feel pretty good. I sleep good. I eat fairly well. I don't understand. I have no symptoms. I don't feel bad. And so the best advice I got was from my dear brother, who told me, just breathe, relax, it's okay. You're not dying tomorrow. Just take time, learn, get information. And so that's exactly what I did. I followed up with an ENT, which is who they recommended. And I did not tell them about my pharmacy background. He was very arrogant and very... like, his way was the only way. There was no other option. And it was a lot of scare tactics and telling me that if I didn't go through with having surgery, he wanted to cut me from here all the way up to behind my ear, rip out my whole thyroid gland, whole bunch of lymph nodes, and then give me radiation. And I looked at him and I said, I'm not feeling sick. Don't you think that's a little bit too much? And he said, no, I treat this all the time. This is the protocol. And I said, well, I don't know that I'm comfortable with that. I think I might look into some alternatives. And he said, well, that would be a mistake, because I can treat this now, but if you leave it in 2 years, you're going to come back and you're going to have softballs on the side of your neck and it'll go to your lungs, and then I can't help you. So I left his office in tears, not really knowing, and I'm very confused. By the way, obviously, I didn't have the surgery, and I don't have softballs on the side of my neck or anything. So, so I started looking into some local doctors, and there's a Geyer Institute here in town, and I went to him, and immediately he told me, what we need to do first is find the root cause. Why did this happen? I mean, you're young. You seem to be in fairly good health. So let's do some blood work. Let's check. Let's find out why this cancer was able to grow in the first place. So through blood works and labs, they found out that my immune system was just very destroyed. I had very low vitamin D and vitamin K and vitamin A, and all of those important things were just in the gutter. So his approach was, let's build your immune system back up and help your body be more equipped to fight off this cancer on its own. So we started doing some IV vitamin C therapy, a little bit of UVB light therapy, and adding some ozone to my blood, a few things like that. And we monitored it regularly. Every 6 months, I would get an ultrasound just to make sure that it hadn't grown or spread or anything. and it never spread, it never grew, but it also didn't go away. And when I found out about Cancun and what they had to offer, and I watched the Truth About Cancer document series that was on TV, or on the internet, sorry, they talked about the Cancun Clinic and how they've been helping people for 25 years with all different kinds of cancer. And I told my husband, I said, this is it. I think this is what I've been holding out for. And so we decided to take the leap and go to Cancun.
Okay, so, and before that part, you didn't really mention, talk about your lifestyle, you know, before diagnosis and after diagnosis. And I think that's we can't miss that as far as why you didn't have softballs on the side of your neck before you went to Cancun.
Yeah, well, and I realized too that part of it is my fault. Being younger, I grew up on the diet of, you know, Cheerios and SpaghettiOs and, you know, all the sugary cereal, all the processed foods, all of that. That's what we grew up on. And so I ate that junk for years and years and years and years. When I got the cancer diagnosis, we had already kind of been on a more healthy eating trend the few years prior. But the second I found out, I cut out sugar completely. Everything that turned to sugar, everything. I cut out gluten. We did very, very, very little red meat, if ever. Cut out pork. All those things that I found out were toxic and would cause more trouble, because I wanted to just feed my body the good nutrition that it needed to be able to fight off. Because I really truly believe your body has the capability of fighting these things. It just needs the help to do it. And food is by far the number one thing that you can do to really help yourself.
Who ever heard of a vitalistic pharmacist? Okay, so, you know, and you also started exercising more?
Yes, I actually teach exercise now at the YMCA, and it doesn't pay anything, but it's the best job I've ever had. I love it. I get to be on the preventative side of things now, so I get to teach people about exercise and the importance of it. I get to talk to them about their diet and healthy eating choices and just really being preventative and not letting themselves get to the disease state, trying to avoid it. So,
guys, what sounds cooler, teaching exercise or I teach hip-hop aerobics? Because that's what she really does.
It's a dance class, yeah.
Yeah. They, like, break out dancing in the middle of malls and stuff. It's pretty funny.
Okay, so the
last question. So tell them about your process through Cancun, and what was your experience there? Your personal experience. How did you feel when you went? How did you feel when you started treatment? What were your side effects? How did you spend your time there? How did you feel after you left? You know, and just kind of break that down for them quick.
Okay. When I called Cancun to find out more information, they asked me, well, can you come next week? And I was like, well, no, I need a little bit more prep time than that. It was a 3-week stay, which is a lot, but I'm telling you, it was the best 3 weeks. I actually, at some points, almost felt guilty because I felt like I was on a vacation, kind of.
I felt bad.
Yeah. The scenery is just amazing. You're right on the ocean. They put you up in a really nice hotel. The clinic is beautiful. You're sitting in a chair and you've just got this view of the ocean. And it's gorgeous. The staff is fantastic. They make you feel welcome and at home. And it's just a very quiet, relaxed, healing area. I mean, it's just amazing because you have all this time. Like, you have a couple hours that you go to the clinic every day for 6 days of the week. And then the rest of the time, you're free. But it was a lot of time to just sit and think and pray, relax, meditate, focus on healing, which is so important. You know, you take away all those everyday stressful things and really just kind of get down to the basics of, okay, body, come on, let's do this, let's heal. The therapies were amazing. I mean, every other day you'd get a lymphatic massage, which who doesn't like a massage? They do coffee enemas every day, which was an interesting experience. But it's not as bad as it sounds, and it really does. You can feel the difference once it really starts detoxing your body. You can tell a big difference when you haven't done it for a while. But the main two that I did, the viral therapy and the PNC27, I virtually had no side effects at all. I got up, I got breakfast, I went to the clinic for a couple hours, I sat in a chair, I got a massage. I mean, I got stuck once a day with an IV. That was about the most uncomfortable. But none of the treatments gave me any kind of side effects. The only thing that happened in 3 weeks is I got food poisoning because I ate in the wrong part of town one day. I think the chicken was a chicken. So I definitely experienced Montezuma's revenge a little bit. But other than that, it was just such a fantastic experience. It was so... I found my happy place in Cancun, and I hope to be able to go back because it was just amazing.
When I did go back with her, I spent most of the time trailing behind her. She was running around hugging people.
Aww.
Like, do you know that person? At the mall? Really?
Yeah, and you form such a close bond with all the other patients that are there because you're all on the same page. You're all fighting the same battle. I was lucky in that a lot of the patients that were there had already exhausted the surgery and the chemo and the radiation, and it hadn't worked, or it had come back, and this was kind of a last-ditch effort. So their body was already bombarded by all of those things, and so then they're not only trying to fight cancer, but they're trying to fight all the bad effects from all of their other previous treatments. So I felt very grateful that I had not done those other things first because I had that much of a better head start. But the people there are amazing. I mean, it was people from all over the world. We had a guy from Norway, we had people from Canada, we had a guy from New Zealand, just everywhere. And we're all there for each other. You really become a family. And I still contact most everybody that I met while I was down there, and we update each other and keep in touch and encourage and pray for one another, and it's fantastic.
And how are you doing now?
I am doing so good. Michael
sure?
And I went down.
You're looking kind of rough.
He's my little brother. I can smack him if I need to. I'm good. Michael and I went down for my 3-month checkup, and they did an ultrasound and blood work and everything, and the tumor had shrunk. And my blood work was even better than when I left. Now, I will say, in the 3 weeks I was there, generally they tell you, don't expect much change because it's only 3 weeks. However, I did see change in just the 3 weeks that I was there. Several of my little nodules had gone down. Two had actually gotten a little bigger, which they said was good. It meant that there was inflammation that my body was attacking and fighting it, and it usually inflames a little bit before it starts to shrink. I was really excited because I told my husband the other day, for the first time, I noticed that the little lump on the side of my neck, I feel like it's probably half the size it was about a year ago. So I know it's working.
Unfortunately, you were also not excited about the news that you got regarding access.
Yes. So when I left Cancun, they give you 3 months worth of therapy is what you, so you have the 3 weeks there, and then they send you home, and they send you, like, the day you get back, you have a kit on your door that's got everything you need for the next 3 months. And then at the end of the 3 months, you get an evaluation, and they see how much longer you need to be on these therapies, how you're reacting to them, and what the dosage is and everything. The viral therapy that I get, it's a once-a-month injection for me. And it's expensive, but the FDA has gotten wind that there's a lot of us getting it. So they're cracking down. And it used to be that we could call the clinic and order it, and they would ship it next day on dry ice because it has to remain frozen. It's a live virus. But they have made it so that they are no longer able to do that. So now as patients, if we want the medicine, we have to physically go to either Cancun or Tijuana, those are their two clinics, and pick it up to try and bring it back with us. We cannot have it delivered via mail or UPS with us anymore.
And the key there is to try to pick it up. Because of course now you have to deal with immigration, customs, in order to get it into the U.S. So depending on who you contact, you might go down there and pick up thousands of dollars worth of medications, and they won't let you in with into the country with it. And they will just...
Yeah.
So can you just go to get the treatment there? Just to go
Yeah, you can move there.
You have to go once a month, right? I mean, you have to go once a month.
You would have to go once a month, yeah. That's about the only real guarantee, is go down there, get an injection, and fly back.
Yeah, luckily, because I knew it was coming, I was able to order about 8 months worth out so that I would just have it. So I have it through next summer, and I don't have to worry about it for now. But I don't know what some of my other friends are doing. I haven't heard from them yet about being able to get it. So.
Didn't you actually tell me that you had that stolen from your house and you don't actually physically have it anymore, right? Yes. And this is being recorded. Say yes.
Yes, it is no longer in my possession.
Yeah. Okay, well, does anybody in here have any questions for Julie while we've got her on here?
Where is she at?
Don't be shy.
Where is she at? Where are you at?
Don't
you want to know where you were?
Don't answer.
She's actually in that room over there. We're totally playing with you guys. We wanted to try out.
I wish. I bet it's a lot warmer there.
Yeah. No, they live in Indianapolis.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
So how long did they say it would take until it's completely gone?
Well, they don't know for sure. I mean, everybody's body chemistry is different and everybody reacts differently, so they really do it on an individual case basis. I do know that the clinic overall, for all the cancers that they treat, have an 86% cure rate, which is a whole lot higher than conventional medicine. So they think that probably maybe a year I'll be on these therapies, and then hopefully I'll be able to. I go again for another ultrasound in 3 months. So we just kind of take it one at a time and see where it's at.
And of course it depends on your lifestyle too, because your lifestyle dictates how you're going to respond to them.
Exactly. Yeah, you have to do the diet, you have to do the exercise, you have to do those other things with it. Get adjusted, that's huge. Yeah, all those things, you gotta have it. Detoxing.
So are your U.S. doctors like willing to work with you, and have you told them about the doctors that you've seen?
The one doctor that I see up here, Dr. Geyer, yes, he knows. And he's told me any blood work that I need to do, any ultrasounds, anything that needs to be ordered, he's more than happy to do that and send the results to them. So yes, he is. Now I will say he runs his own clinic because he was so tired of working and just the regular MD stuff, not really being able to treat people, that he decided to open his own clinic. And he does these kind of alternative therapies. So he is open to that. Most doctors don't want a part of this. So.
Yeah. Her answer was like a pediatrician with an unvaccinated child.
Yes.
Next question. Yes.
Of the 86%, how many do they ever get cancer again? What is cured?
She said of the 86% success rate, how many of those get cancer again?
None that I'm aware of. I don't know for sure. You can check the website, the Hope for Cancer website. But one of the things that I love about the viral therapy that I'm doing is that any patient who's had cancer ever in their lifetime has cancer stem cells in their body. And this is something I just learned about a couple months ago. I didn't know they existed. But when you've had cancer, your body has cancer stem cells that are there. Chemo and radiation will not and cannot destroy cancer stem cells. So those stem cells are still in your body, floating around. And given the right circumstances and opportunity, they will cause another tumor to grow somewhere else. Now, chemotherapy and radiation won't destroy cancer stem cells, but they do make them more aggressive. So there's research out there proven that people who get chemotherapy and radiation, the primary tumor is gone, but when their cancer comes back, it sometimes comes back in the same spot, sometimes somewhere else, but it's always more aggressive. And now it is immune to what you got before. That therapy will no longer work on it. In contrast, the viral therapy that I'm doing specifically targets cancer stem cells. So it not only goes in your body and actively hunts down cancer cells, it also hunts down the cancer stem cells and destroys them, meaning there are no cancer cells left to reestablish. Now, if you lived a really bad lifestyle and had lots of toxic things you were exposed to or whatever, yeah, the chances of cancer, of course, could come back. But I think for the majority of people that, you know, choose to invest that money to go to that, you're going to work really hard to try and keep your lifestyle where it needs to be to avoid cancer being able to return. So,
yes.
I was also going to ask, when she went home for those 3 months, other than the monthly injection, what were some other things that she continued doing at home?
Okay. I heard her. Well, so they send you home with some supplements, which you take every day. The other therapy, other than the viral injection, is the PNC27, and it's a suppository. So you do that twice a day, sometimes once a day. It depends on your type of cancer and what they decide your dose is. You continue the coffee enemas at home once or twice a week, and they send you the kit. They send you everything you need, and it's not intimidating. It's pretty easy to do. And then there's a couple other things too, but it's all just the therapies that you learn about while you're there. They just have you continue them at home. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Any others? Yes.
The viral therapy she's got 8 months worth. How long does that really last? Let's say she had no longer use it. How do you keep it?
Do you know how long the rig gear lasts? If it's frozen, if you don't use it, how long it will last?
I don't really know shelf life. I would assume it's probably stable for at least a year. I don't really know. I'd have to look at the box and see. It's from Latvia, which is a European country, and the entire box is in Latvian, and I don't read or speak Latvian, so I don't really know. Sorry. But I know if you get it and it's frozen, as long as it stays frozen, it's fine. And then you just take it out and you let it thaw for 5 to 10 minutes. It's 2 mils of liquid. So it's just a small amount, and it's an intramuscular injection. So you don't have to do it IV or anything. You just right in your shoulder or in your backside and you're done.
Yes.
The PNC27, has there been a problem with? You said that's still not FDA approved either.
Right. Did you hear that? Okay.
Yeah. The PNC27, I believe, was discovered by a scientist here in the U.S., and he started getting some really good results from it, so the FDA shut it down and wouldn't let him, like, patent it or anything. So then the clinics in Mexico and other places took it and continued on with it and found it to be effective, so...
Can she get it? I mean, she's still...
Can you get it? Do you have access to the PNC?
I order it through the clinic. So I don't know. I call them. I get a month at a time because it is really expensive.
Right. Like the rig beer is being shut down from coming in. Are they also shutting down the PNC?
No.
Oh.
Not right now. It's just a suppository, so I don't know. Maybe they don't care about suppositories. They're like, if you want to do it, go for it. I don't know.
What are they, breath mints?
Hey, as being a pharmacist, you would not believe some of the things people in dermal suppositories, I will just say.
If I was going through customs, I'd be like, heck yeah, man, you got to try one of these. All right, any other questions?
What's it like to grow up with Mike?
Why are you much cuter than he is?
I love you, Michael. I'm not going to answer that.
She didn't answer.
He was
any other legitimate questions?
Just thank her for sharing.
Thank you, guys. You're lucky to have Dr. Mike. He's wonderful. I wish I lived closer so I could go to him too.
Love you, sis.
Yeah. All right, love you too. Take care.
Bye. All right. Well, guys, that concludes. That wraps it all up. Obviously, I don't think I have to say I hope you learned something out of tonight. I'm pretty sure you guys all got something out of it. So, you know, where do you go with this? That's really what you have to go and ponder tonight. Like, what do you do with this now? I mean, it's not like you just learned how to,
crochet a blanket.
There you go. I was having trouble coming up. You know, it's this is one of those heavy subjects, you know, where it's like, once you know, you have a moral obligation to make sure other people know, you know, so, and cancer is such a difficult place, and I want to give you this one last bit of understanding here, based on my experience. And you guys have probably seen the same to agree. Cancer has ceased to become a medical condition in terms of medical conditions. It has become a faith initiative, in a sense. And what I mean by that is, have you noticed how when people get cancer, or they get diagnosed, they immediately shut off rational thought, they shut off listening or challenging options or watching videos or reading books or anything else like that? They shut it all off. And they basically, their response for 90% of people will be, my treatment starts this Thursday. Mm-hmm. And that's it. They don't want to hear from you. Okay, and psychologically, what that tells you is that they have not made a decision per se. They are putting their faith in that treatment.
Yeah.
That to that person, if they challenge what they're about to do, that somehow it's not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
As if it's coming from God Himself. Like, I am not going to challenge my thought process on this because I have to go in it with complete and total faith that I'm going to survive it.
Mm-hmm.
There's something wrong with that, you know, but it makes it very difficult for the deliverer of information. You know, it's one of those tough things, like, how do you tell a parent that, you know, something that they just did to their child was not the right thing to do to their child.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not talking about any specific topic. I mean, maybe they had a bad reaction to Tylenol or something. But how do you tell them that they did it? Because they're not going to accept that. You know, I mean, there's these barriers that we put around our minds to allow us to deal with things. And it becomes a faith-based thing. So really what you have to do is you have to be prepared in advance.
You have to educate people in advance. Don't wait for them to get cancer. Share information. Be presumptive about it. Be proactive about it. Preempt their diagnosis. If you know that they're living a bad lifestyle, be like, look, you know, I ain't saying you're going to get cancer. I just want to share you information because everybody needs to know about this. Everybody needs to know that there's other options out there. You know, and be willing to stand up. You know, that's the thing nowadays. You know, I started off the workshop with saying, you know, to each his own, right? I know you guys all remember that. But, you know, that is a balance. It goes with to each his own, but at the same time, being willing to give them the option and the opportunity to communicate out of love, and then deal with their with their acceptance of it on the level of, you know what, that's your decision. I mean, that's fine either way. I love you still, but, you know, I did my part, right? You know, so it's that balance of the two, and it's just really just walking in love. So share the information, but understand that it is on an offensive topic. Yes, it is. I know everybody knows that. But you still have to do it. You say, you know, out of love, you still have to do it. Because if you don't, then there is no chance here that they're going to find this stuff. Or anything that may come down the pipe that is the same level, right? Okay.